I'm ready to turn the mic over to tonight's introducer, and he'll let you know why he's a very appropriate introducer for tonight's speaker, for a very special reason. But I will just also tell you that it took tonight's speaker and me several breakfasts to convince our introducer, mathematician Ken Ribet, that he needed to skip his last class of the semester and come here to introduce the speaker. And I'm delighted that we were at last successful after a couple of, no, I couldn't possibly do that. And so we're very grateful that Ken Ribet is here with us to introduce tonight's speaker.
Thank you very much, Cindy. Very often when I come to introduce a speaker, I have to rely on notes. And actually, tonight is a little bit different because the speaker this evening is actually my wife, Lisa Goldberg. And so I know quite a lot about the speaker and can tell you about her with great confidence. On the other hand, I make no claim whatsoever to being a disinterested observer. Before introducing Lisa as a person, as an individual, I just want to say that the two of us grew up in the New York metropolitan area. I was born in Brooklyn before there were hipsters there, and we both went to public schools. I went to Far Rockaway High School, which no longer exists. Lisa was a professor at the City University of New York when I first met her. She worked at the Graduate Center, which was on 42nd Street at the time, and in Brooklyn College, which many of you know. We are the parents of two wonderful daughters who are now independent and in their 20s. And now I can talk to you about Lisa. Lisa was trained in a subject in mathematics called algebraic topology when she came to New York to work with Dennis Sullivan and John Milner and other mathematicians whose names are familiar to the professionals in the audience. She began working in a subject called complex dynamics, which moved her quite a bit from her original focus in mathematics. And then when she moved out to Berkeley, she moved even further. She became one of the pioneers among the mathematicians who began working on Wall Street and elsewhere in mathematical finance. And I think Lisa's move exemplifies the fact that mathematicians who are trained to think very carefully and precisely and deeply about an individual subject can be very diverse and very mobile and work in different subjects. This is a phenomenon that our colleague Mark Green from UCLA calls the mathematical diaspora. And Lisa is now very well known and very accomplished in the field of mathematical finance. She has a string of patents to her name, also many articles in academic journals and many articles in practitioner journals, in journals for mathematical finance professionals. She currently works as director of research at a portfolio management company in the San Francisco Bay Area called Aperio. She's also co-founder and director of research for a organization on the UC Berkeley campus called CEDAR, which is the Center for Analysis of Risk. And in these two roles, Lisa works on many questions involving mathematics and works with students and colleagues. She's a great collaborator, as many of the best mathematicians have become. And tonight, she's going to tell you about something that's not related directly to mathematical finance. Instead, it's related to basketball. And so, Lisa, I call upon you to talk about the hot hand.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you, dear. That was very nice. And thank you, Cindy, for the kind invitation to be here tonight. Thank you, MoMath, for putting together this amazing event. I've been watching the videographers and the sound people, and I had no idea it was this complicated to tape a math talk. So I'm quite overwhelmed. I'd also like to mention, so the title is a little bit West Coast. Do Steph Curry and Klay Thompson have hot hands? So maybe you guys have heard of them. If not, they play for the Golden State Warriors, and they both score a lot. Those guys. Yeah, they're currently playing in the second round of the final postseason playoffs against the Houston Rockets, and it's been an interesting series from another number of perspectives so far. I'd like to mention my co-authors, Alain Dox, who's here in the front row, I'm delighted to say, and Nishant Desai, who is 3,000 miles away, but I hope, I don't know, I hope he's thinking about this, and we'll tell you a little bit about this talk. Ken said that it's not really, that it's different from mathematical finance. Actually, there's quite a lot of overlap between sports statistics and the way financial markets work on all kinds of levels, parallels through gambling, parallels through economic systems involving salary caps and distribution of wealth. And I'm not the only one. There seems to be all of a sudden a whole bunch of articles coming from finance professionals and going out on the web. So I think we're going to be, hopefully the two subjects are going to be learning more and more from each other. Working on this paper is not so different, I find, from working on financial economics, certainly not as different as, say, algebraic topology is. But as Ken said, one of the great things about mathematics, if you learn it, is that you get used to the idea of asking questions and getting to the bottom of things as well as you can. Mathematicians, more than any other group I know, refuse to take things for granted and try to understand deeply, and it's been a skill that has been good for me all of my life. I do mathematics every day. I started very young, and it's always fun. Now, in this particular research project, touches on many different themes that have become interesting and important to me, and some maybe even life-changing over time. Mathematics is certainly one of those, and others will emerge as we go through this talk. Obviously, basketball is going to come up. But before I talk at all about basketball, I want to talk about something that happened to me 7 years ago. I had a job in industry for a long time at a company called Barra, and we built, and Barra still does, build portfolio risk management tools and models and software, which are all over, used by financial services all over the world. So if you have a 401k planner, you manage money in any kind of way, you're probably touched by what that company did, which is and does, which is quite amazing. But after being there for almost two decades, I left, taking quite a risk in the sense that I didn't make a new plan for myself. It was May of 2012, and I just kind of walked out the door, and all of a sudden I had lots of time. And so when you're in that situation, if you've ever been in a situation like that, it's kind of interesting what you pick up. I was had been a book review editor for a journal called Quantitative Finance. It's one of these medium journals between academic and practitioner, the kind that Ken was mentioning. And so I assigned myself a book to review. And that book is called Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. So I wonder if any of you know that book. Yeah, lots of people know that book. Daniel Kahneman, before I tell you about the book, I'll tell you about Kahneman. He is a psychologist, and he won the Nobel Prize in Economics in 2001. And so you can ask, why is a psychologist winning a Nobel Prize in Economics? And it's because the work that he did in collaboration with a guy named Amos Tversky, who I will talk about quite a bit, laid the foundation for behavioral economics and behavioral finance. And I had always wanted to learn about that. We didn't do very much of it at Barra, and this was my opportunity. So I got the book. It was very popular. An amazing thing, Kahneman wrote this. It was a best-selling book, a huge best-selling book. He wrote it when he was 77 years old, so that's something to think about. And this book is this book is a compendium, in part, at least the first two-thirds of it, of the research that Kahneman did with Tversky, Amos Tversky, his partner, who did not win the Nobel Prize in 2001. Why is that? Because Tversky died in 1996 of melanoma. Nobel Prizes, I've always been wondered why this is, but they're not given posthumously. So there's Kahneman. He's winning this Nobel Prize in a subject that's not his subject, for work, which he regarded as something that was a partnership. And this book is very much a tribute to Tversky. And so what is it that makes behavioral finance and behavioral economics go? If you've ever taken an economics course, standing in the middle of it is homo economus, or this guy who makes a lot of rational decisions. He's got to decide whether to invest in stock A or stock B, and so he kind of thinks through all of the rational implications of this choice and then does something optimal. So we all know that people don't really act like that. In fact, people do very emotional things. And what Kahneman and Tversky did that has translated into the subject of behavioral economics is understood in a systematic and deep and novel and remarkable way how it is we make mistakes, deviate from rationality. And I'll just give two examples, because a lot of the stuff that has grown out of their work has become very familiar today. Maybe you guys have heard of like hindsight bias, which is that, you know, the world looks very complicated when you look forward into the future, but when you look backward, you think, well, you know, I should have known that, or I could have predicted that, or that makes a lot of sense that it turned out that way, right? The reason for that is because the way we remember the things that turned out to matter, and we forget a lot of other stuff. So this is a bias. Another one that's very important is called confirmation bias, which means that when we're out trying to figure out what's true and what's false, we tend to have an idea in our heads about it, and we look for evidence that confirms what we believe instead of looking for evidence, as we should do if we're good scientists, that tears down our theories, or we should be balanced about it, but it's very hard. Now, why is it that we do these things? Many of the biases that we have are linked in fundamental ways to the way that we misunderstand randomness. And this is really a theme that runs through all of Kahneman and Tversky's work. Seeing something, it's out there. Maybe this is just chance events. But instead, we look for patterns in what we see, whether there are patterns there or not. We're pattern-seeking individuals. So if I say to you, 1, 2, 3, you might say 4, 5, 6, right? That's a natural progression. Or if you're a mathematician, maybe you would say 5, 8, 13, right? You might make a Fibonacci sequence. Those are both patterns. One's a little bit more esoteric than the other. But hardly anybody would just throw out 3 random numbers. We don't do it. We don't like randomness. We look for meaning in what we see. And so that has, I would say, that book has changed the way I think about everything. And I try to always keep in mind what I've learned from Kahneman's book. And one more thing, and this is perhaps the most amazing, is that we can be as introspective and as conscious as we want of the types of mistakes that Kahneman and Tversky have documented that we make. And we will make them again and again and again. You might be able to get out of it sometimes by really focusing on a specific thing, but your mind will let go, and you will make these mistakes over and over again. You will tend to try to confirm what you believe. You will tend to try to see patterns when there may or may not be any. You will tend to look backward and say, you know, I should have known that all along. So that is certainly kind of an important element of the work that I'll present here. So sports is another theme, particularly basketball. I grew up watching basketball. In fact, I grew up watching this team. These are the New York Knicks from the 70s when they were they used to dominate. They used to dominate the league. So this is Dick Barnett, Walt Frazier, the guy in the middle there without his shirt, that's former senator and presidential hopeful Bill Bradley, Dave DeBuscher, and Willis Reed. These were certainly not all the Knicks that I'd like to talk about. It was the best picture I could find, though. So you wouldn't you would want to talk about Cassie Russell, about Jerry Lucas, certainly about Earl Monroe. This is, Earl the Pearl, right? I mean, these guys were amazing. And I loved watching this team. In fact, my parents were here for the afternoon session. My mother's in her 80s and my father's in his 90s, and my brother unfortunately couldn't make it, but we would sit around and watch game after game. This was like a really important part of my childhood, and we would always talk about who had the hot hand, because it was very often this guy, Walt Frazier. He would start shooting and it would just seem like he couldn't miss. And this was a real phenomenon. I watch a lot of basketball now, mostly the Warriors, but as Ken will tell you, I've kind of drag us into many, many other teams as well, not just the local ones. We be watching all the time. And when you see a top player start to score, you really feel like something has changed in that player, and that player's a good bet. Has a hot hand, get that guy the ball, he's gonna score for your team. So everybody knows about the hot hand. Players know it. Fans know it, coaches know it, God knows, commentators know it. Here's a quote, typical from the old days, 1970s, out of the Times. Bill Bradley has taken over the hot hand from one of his teammates. And here are some photographs that Ken took when we drove by Oracle Arena, which is where the Warriors have played and are still playing for the next few games. I'm sad to say they're moving into San Francisco, but if you drive up and down 880 in California, you drive right by the Warriors, and it's been like a big shrine with giant pictures of the star players and a big hot hand sign out in front of it. And you might say, well, it could be surprising to see as late as 2017 to be seeing the hot hand or hearing about the hot hand. Because in 1985, which was like 10 years after I was watching the great New York Knicks, but still a long time ago today, three researchers published a study saying that there was no such thing as the hot hand. It was a cognitive illusion. So if you look at the names, I maybe should have highlighted them, three here on the study, Thomas Gilovich, Robert Vallone, and Amos Tversky, that very same Tversky, who did not get the Nobel Prize, but was a real expert in seeing in how people see made-up patterns and stuff. So these three researchers published a study arguing that there was no such thing as the hot hand. The result was surprising, and while scholars were very excited by the result and really excited. So if you're in a scholarly discipline, maybe some of you are, you know, you work when you write a paper, you do a study or you prove a theorem or you work for like years and then you work for more years trying to write the thing well and make sure that it's something people will understand and enjoy, and then you put the paper up and nobody pays the slightest bit of attention to it. This is something that I think has happened to everybody in academia. Even the more successful academicians have stuff that they worked very hard on and nobody paid attention to, but everybody paid attention to this paper. All of a sudden, I mean, if you look up the hot hand literature that cites it, there are thousands of papers. Like, academics thought, wow, everybody's misunderstanding something. How cool is that? Let's go see what else people are misunderstanding. On the other hand, the NBA didn't think highly of the result. So this is Red Auerbach, who was a famous coach and president of the NBA. And he looked at the thing and he said, you know, guy's got to be kidding. What do I care? Of course there's a hot hand. And so if this sounds kind of familiar, like the experts who have the experience and the knowledge and the intuition versus the egghead academicians who are too smart for their own good and think they know better than everybody, even though they have no experience with the subject. There's that kind of thing going on today, maybe over climate science, or if you've read in sports, again, if you've read Michael Lewis's Moneyball. And so who's right and who's wrong? Well, it's kind of a question. So let's see how a little bit more about how the original study worked. So in the original study, these guys did something that maybe is very elementary, but also kind of, it's nice to do simple things. They took a player's performance and represented the thing as a string of zeros and ones, zero if you miss the shot, and one if you make the shot. And then they went to measure hot-handedness in the string. They went to see if there were unusual streaks, or maybe after a streak, if there was more likely to be another hit. They made a measurement, and I'll tell you exactly how their measurement worked. In fact, in reality, in their paper, they did lots of different measurements that are pretty similar, but they looked at the problems from several different ways. And then they used statistics to decide whether something was unusual going on in those strings that came corresponded to players' shooting records compared to other strings. It's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. They found no evidence that star shooters had hot hands. In fact, for some of the players, they found an anti-hot hand. They found that the player seemed to be more likely to make a shot after he just missed some. And according to the statistics they used, the difference in the wrong direction was statistically significant. So this was their findings, the findings that Red Auerbach thought he should not pay any attention to. This is just ridiculous. And there are, in fact, a lot of reasons why they might have gotten that result. One reason might be that the representation of performance was just much too simple. So here is an example. This guy in the red is James Harden, who was the most valuable player in the 2017-2018 season. We'll see if he gets it again. I don't know. And here he is making a relatively easy shot where the defenders are behind him. And here he's making another kind of shot where he's got two warriors between him and the ball. So if he made those, they would get a one. If he missed them, they'd get a zero. But obviously, the difficulty of the shot is different. And this was not accounted for in the original study. Also, the dynamics of the game of basketball. What happens, maybe James Harden starts getting a hot hand and his opponents change their strategy to shut him down, right? So accounting for the defense. And there are a lot of papers that try to improve on, criticize, reverse, I don't know what you want to call it, the original study by taking these more nuanced and empirically obviously important effects into account. So that's worth doing if you've ever published. So I don't know, maybe there's some empirical researchers here. This is pretty typical. If you put out an empirical study, I mean, people will criticize if they pay attention to it at all. They will criticize every aspect of it. It's not realistic. You should have used a different time period. This is overfitting. I mean, you can criticize all of them. And these are valid criticisms. When you start making something more complicated, though, you do tend to introduce new kinds of errors that you didn't think of. Making something more realistic is not necessarily making it better. So you can decide if you want whether you think the more simple representation that neglects these things gives you a stronger point, or a more complex representation that takes account of them makes a stronger point. I think the original authors liked their explanation. They liked the explanation that people were just misperceiving what was going on. There were not streaks in the data. People felt there were streaks in the data because they were very excited about the basketball. And so they made up some story after the fact to explain what had happened. So here's an example of looking back on some data and creating a narrative around it. Tversky has been lauded by many for being incredibly insightful on the details of how we misunderstand randomness. This particular quote comes out of Michael Lewis's book, The Undoing Project. So for those of you who have not heard of Kahneman and Tversky, probably everybody's heard of Michael Lewis. He's one of the most famous writers in the United States, right, with Moneyball, which I mentioned before, and The Blind Side, and a lot of books. He wrote a book called The Undoing Project, which is the story of Kahneman and Tversky's friendship and research partnership, and also gives quite a bit of technical detail, as only Michael Lewis can, in a way that's very, very accessible. It's a super wonderful book, if you haven't read it. But Lewis, in his 2017 book, just like Kahneman in his 2011 book, Thinking Fast and Slow, praised this hot hand study as a testament to how insightful Amos Tversky was about cognitive issues and perception. So here are two competing explanations for some study. But in 2015, when I was sitting in a seminar, I heard a third explanation, one that I had never heard anything like before. And these two guys, Josh Miller and Adam Sangiorgio, explained that the reason that Tversky and Gilovich and Vallone had not found a hot hand is because they did their statistics wrong. There was an actual mistake in the study. So this is like amazing, because these were kind of godlike academics, extremely influential. And this is not saying you didn't account for something. This is like you screwed up. And so I can direct you to their paper for the full details. Goes on and on. It's a paper in a journal, a fancy academic journal called Econometrica, that talks about what they found. I heard this, as I said, in a seminar. Ken mentioned we have a research institute at Cal called CDAR, that's Consortium for Data Analytics and Risk. We have a weekly seminar. And these two students were in the seminar giving a talk. They were students jointly in the law school and the statistics program, and they were building a robotic judge. And one of them happened to mention this mistake. And of course, having spent so much time on Kahneman's book and trying to learn as much as I could about behavior, since I knew all about the subject, I was amazed that there could have been a mistake. I certainly didn't notice it. And I sort of, I confess, stopped listening to them a little bit and started looking. I had my laptop with me, as I do, started looking for the error. And indeed, it is a mistake. So I'm going to try and explain, this is their explanation, not mine, how the thing works. So it works by playing a game. You can see the entire mistake in this game. So we're going to flip a coin, and we're going to think maybe the coin's like a shot string. So it should be like 20 or 25 or 18 flips in a row. But you can already see the issue for three times. And so I'm going to just play a game where we flip a coin three times. And this coin is a fair coin, so it's 50 heads, tails. And the flips are completely independent. What happens on the next flip has nothing to do with what happens on the previous flip. And so the way the game works is that I flip the coin, and you have a piece of paper. And when I flip the coin the first time, you do nothing. You pay attention. And if it's a tails, you just sit there. But if it's heads, you become alert. And then after the heads, you write down what happens. So flip tails, you do nothing. I flip heads, you become alert. If I flip heads, you write a second time after the heads, you write down a heads, okay? So you're writing down what happens after I flip a heads and doing nothing else. It's a 50-50 coin. The flips are independent. And the question is, what do you expect to have on your piece of paper after we've played this game? Half heads, half tails, right? We're writing down what happens after heads. And of course, what happens after heads has nothing to do with what just happened, because the coins are independent. So you would expect to have 50% heads and 50% tails. That's what Tversky thought. But it's not true. And it's not true, as you can see here. there is a small sample bias. So in a string of three, these 2^3 power equal 8 things are all the things that can happen. So if I were to flip 3 tails, you would have written nothing. If I were to have flipped tail, head, you would have written nothing. Now here, you would have write something down. Tail, we do nothing. Heads, we pay attention. We write down the tails. Here, heads, you pay attention right away. You write down the tails. Now you do nothing. For this one, you get an H and a T. H-T-H, you get only a T again, right? Because you don't do anything after that last heads. Here, you get only an H. And here, you get two H's. So if you look at the fractions on your pieces of paper, in the cases where you actually had a heads, you actually had a shot, you're thinking the heads is like a basketball shot and the tails, the heads is one that made it and the tails is one that missed, 0% were heads, 0. Here is a 0.5, 0, 1, and 1. And if you add them up and divide by 6, you get something less than a half. 2.5 over 6 is definitely less than a half. It's 5/12. So this is kind of remarkable. I think the calculation is very easy to do. What is takes thought is to ask why this is relevant to the problem that we were working on. And the answer is we're looking to see what is the fraction of shots you make or miss after a string. This is exactly the predictor of it. It's an estimator. It's an estimator that's biased downward. Why is it biased downward? It's biased downward because of the 3. If we had done this for an infinite string, it would have been 50-50. But as long as you do a finite string, there's a downward bias. The downward bias, which is the difference between 0.5, which is what we think we should have, and the actual estimator, these are the number of flips, the bias gets smaller as the number of flips gets larger. If you go all the way to infinity, that bias disappears. But it's actually pretty big around here, around 20. And if you look not just at what happens after one heads, but if you were looking at what happens after 2 heads, or after 3 heads, or after 4 heads, where the same principle is still there, you would think it should be 50-50 because it's a next shot and they're independent. These biases are pretty large. And these empirical estimators are what are called in statistics consistent estimators, which means as the number of flips goes to infinity, the bias will go away, but it's there at every finite level. So this was the insight that these two statisticians, San Giorgio and Miller, noticed after 30 years of everybody arguing about this paper. So what do they think? Well, here are some implications of the bias. First of all, in a finite sequence of independent coin flips, when the coin is fair, a reversal is actually more likely than a continuation. In the original experiment, if you'd accounted for this, which the original experimenters did not, it made it easier to find a hot hand, making you think that if you redid their experiment, maybe the results would reverse. Now, as we know in mathematics, if there's an error in a proof, that doesn't make the conclusion wrong. Sometimes it is, and sometimes it isn't. Authors, who Miller and San Giorgio, who found this small sample bias, claim that after they redid part of the original experiment, they found a reversal in the results. And I don't think I said it earlier, but in the original paper, Gilovich and Vallone and Tversky looked at 3 classes of data. They looked at the Celtics shooting field goals, the 76ers shooting field goals, the Celtics shooting 3 free throws, and then they lined up a whole bunch of Cornell students and said, you take 100 shots, and it was a controlled experiment. And it was in the controlled experiment that they found the reversal. They have 2 very long footnotes in their paper explaining why they didn't check the other parts. They didn't think it was relevant. I don't know. Maybe they didn't have the data. For us, we thought it was the most relevant part, because what's really interesting, anyway, to me and to Alain and to Nichon, was what's happening in the game. But before I explain the experiment we did, I just want to say, for those of you who do play in the stock market, the small sample bias tends to reinforce the gambler's fallacy, which is, you know, my stock went down 10 days in a row, I'm due for a reversal. Well, no, you're not. But everything we see around us tells us that reversals are more common than continuations, all else equal. So if you're interested in doing a psychology experiment, you could actually like test on human subjects and see, does this really, you know, subject them to subtle reinforcements like that and see if it affects their behavior. I don't know if anyone's done that, but I'd be curious what the results would be. Anyway, it's there. And we know as we get more and more deeply connected to the internet, which we seem to do every day, there's all kinds of stuff being pushed at us that subtly affects how we think. So let me explain how the statistic works. So this is a particular shot string for Clay Thompson. Clay Thompson is my personal favorite Golden State Warrior. He's very calm and kind of streaky, shooting-wise, compared to others. But as a defender, he's like reliable and solid and not emotional very interesting player. This is the performance that he had in a game against the Detroit Pistons back in December of 2016, right before Christmas. And this is 16 shots long, and he made half of them, and he missed half of them. So I'm going to explain now the kind of central statistic that was in the original hot hand study. What they did was they looked for all sequences in a row of hits. In this case, we're going to just look at instances of two hits in a row. And then we see there's two of them here, there's one of them here, and there's one of them here. So there's four instances of them. And we can look to see what happens after these hits. Well, we got a one, we got a zero, we got a zero. And then we don't know, because he took 16 shots and the HH came at the end. So empirically, in this string, the empirical probability of a hit given two hits was a third. Tversky and Gilovich and Vallone compared that to the probability of a hit given two misses. So here, we've got five instances of two misses. None of them at the end, so I can work with all of them. And what we find is that after the first two misses, there's a hit, then three misses, then a hit. So the probability of a hit given two misses was 2/5. The kind of instinctive thing is that those things should sort of cancel each other out. And so this minus 1/15 looks like the antithesis of a cold hand. But because of the small sample bias, we might expect this statistic, which we've named T2, to be a little bit less than zero for random strings. So maybe this is something we should look at. The likelihood of a hit after two misses was higher than it was after two hits. This sort of seems like the anti-hot hand. But because of that small sample bias, we need to be careful. So now I'll come to the next theme. I've talked about mathematics. We've talked about behavioral economics. We've talked about basketball. And mathematically, now I'm going to talk about math teams. Because as a much younger mathematician, I somehow learned to think that I had to do everything myself. And when I gave a talk or wrote a paper, whether it was with collaborators or not, and there were not that many collaborative papers back in the old days, I felt like every detail of it was my responsibility. And this is kind of a great instinct in a way. But the flip side of that is that in some ways you're limiting what you can do if you insist on doing only the things that you understand perfectly. And having a bigger team of where your collaborators have skills and knowledge and experience that you don't lets you work on bigger problems. So I had this idea that I'd love to be able to see if this bias how did this all play out in modern data, and I had absolutely no ability to do that because I'm not good at data science or web scraping. I don't really know how to program. I'm not good at designing algorithms, all of these things. And my colleague, Laurent Elgaoui, introduced me to Alain and to Nishant, who had all of basketball at their fingertips and were great at all of these things. So they were not only very mathematical, but also had many, many skills that I did not have. And we figured out a way to look at whether modern basketball players had hot hands or not, in the spirit of the original. The question was, did the original experiment apply to today's players? What conclusion would you get, accounting for what we know now about the small sample bias? So here's Steph Curry, who is generally everybody's favorite player, and there's Clay again. And we looked at the Warriors' 2016-2017 season. There were 82 games in the regular season, and there were, I think somewhat to the Warriors' chagrin, 17 games in the playoffs. Now, they won the NBA championship in 2017, and they would have liked to have won it in a straight sweep. There's four rounds, four out of seven series, and no basketball team today still has ever swept through 4-4, 4-4, and they almost did it, but the Cavaliers, that had LeBron James at the time, beat them once. So there you go. We end up with 99 games. There were low injuries that year. Curry played 96 of them. Thompson played 95 of them. And what we did was we calculated this T2 statistic for each of the players in each of the games. Now here, this is kind of a choice, another empirical choice. If you watch basketball, you might think, well, the player gets hot for a quarter and then cools off or something. This is our perception. So why did we not use quarters? Well, even the best shooters don't attempt more than 20, 25 shots in a game, so you would have not enough data. This is a compromise. It's not really the right length of time to address the thing we're trying to get at. But it's what we had, and even this size data suffers from what statisticians called low power. We wish we had more data. We don't really have it. What we did do was imagine that the team, without paying attention to who was shooting, but the team as a whole might have gotten a hot hand, and it certainly does happen sometime. The Warriors during the season, the average shots that the whole team took in a quarter was not so very different from what star shooters would take over the whole game, so we looked at that as well. These shooting percentages are a little bit higher than you may be used to if you watch basketball. It's because we included both free throws and field goals, 2 points and 3 points, in the shot strings. We didn't distinguish. If we distinguished, we would have lowered the power of our study further. We did rerun the study without free throws, and we didn't get a different answer than the one we got, but these are just choices. So here's our paper. You can find it in the Mathematical Intelligencer and also reprinted in Scientific American from last October, just as the NBA season launched. And what we did was we took each player or the whole team, each player for a game or the whole team for a quarter, and we looked at the shot string through the lens of a permutation test. So we computed that T2 statistic where I got minus 115 before for one of Clay's game, and then we took the string and we scrambled it, thereby wrecking any relationship between what happened before and what happened after, and computed T2 again. And then we permuted it again, and we did T2 again. We can just do it on all the strings or on a very large sampling of them. And this sort of test, which is so easy to do now that we have a lot of computing power, has really not been available for all that long. And it certainly was not something you could have easily done in 1985. Does not suffer from the small sample bias because we are including the size of the string in figuring out what's ordinary. We didn't assume anything about what happened for long strings in trying to assess the statistic on a short string, all of our comparisons are on the same size. So the bias is just corrected by itself. There's kind of an interesting point about this, which is at Berkeley now, there's a new data science division. And if you go into that instead of into traditional statistics, you will be taught statistics using a lot of these finite sample permutation and bootstrapping type methods. And students now think that's the correct way to do it. And of course, you're trading in one set of assumptions for another. There are cases where you would be much better off using analytical formulas and some type of asymptotic assumptions. But I sometimes fear we haven't really educated critical thinking as much as we could and just made a kind of a trade. But in this particular case, if you'd used this methodology, you would have just gotten the right answer instead of having the mistake. So what we do is we create T2 for all these strings. We look at the fraction of T2 values that were bigger than what we observed. We get something called a p-value. And if you got a small p-value, that means that the guy had the hot hand in that game or the team had the hot hand in that quarter. And so going back to Clay's string that we analyzed, here is what you would need for the hot hand, and here is where Clay fell. Even though it was negative, it was kind of right in the middle, but it was nothing extraordinary. So according to this metric, which you can decide whether you like or what you don't like, but it's the one that was emphasized in this famous study, no hot hand for Thompson in that game, even with the correction. So when you run experiments, lots of experiments, you may have heard terms like p-hacking or multiple test hypothesis testing. If you look long enough, something unusual is going to happen. So you might think that if you take a player like Steph Curry, even if he doesn't have a hot hand, he's going to have like a hot game once in a while. So you might expect to have a small p-value, say one that is less than the sacred 5% that is dominates all of empirical study, that's medical studies and social sciences. This is just a standard cutoff that people use for reasons that I don't really know and don't know anybody who knows, but it's certainly the practice. You would just expect to see that 5% of the time. Generalized and said a different way, if I took the p-values over the whole season and took cumulative sums, if there were no effect, I'd see a perfect 45-degree line or something pretty close to it. So this is what we got, some pretty good-looking 45-degree lines. They're not absolutely perfect, but given here are the hot hands down here, I mean, you could argue about whether there's a little effect or a big effect, a little effect or not, but there's certainly not a big effect. There are lots and lots of games where there was just no hot hand. These things were pretty uniformly distributed on the 0-1, the p-values. So we found that even after correcting for the small sample bias, that the original hypothesis seemed to hold, at least in this study. Now, going back to the division between the kind of geeks, the statistician people, and the very experienced and knowledgeable intuitive practitioners, well, it seems now we've come kind of a little bit reversed in a way. Well, not quite reversed. We've got the disagreement in a different place. Ever since the finding of San Giorgio and Miller, now we've got, there's been a new stream of literature making very detailed analyses with lots of bells and whistles, finding hot hands all over the place in spite of our studies. So we no longer have the statisticians versus the practitioners. We have some of the statisticians versus the other statisticians. Our study has been, I think, literally criticized for being mathematically correct but empirically wrong. So, okay, I'll take it. This is one of the most hot hand performances that I've ever seen. It was a little bit before the game I was showing you before. It was Klay Thompson again. He did something truly exceptional by scoring 60 points in a game. If you don't follow basketball, like 120 points is a pretty high-scoring game. So I don't remember what the score was for the game, but he probably scored roughly half the points or maybe more than half the points by himself. That's certainly rare. He shot the ball 44 times. He made 31 of the shots. But did he have a hot hand according to this statistic? Well, no. Here is like the hot hand region, and he was nowhere close. So if this gives you like pause to say, is this the right statistic, that's maybe a very good question. There's a lot of measuring that we do. If you read studies, you'll see, you know, the word like the GDP, or you know, how big is unemployment, or you know, how many people have this disease. We can never measure these things. So scientists, social scientists, physical scientists, well, physicists are a little different. They actually can measure things sometimes. But apart from them, we can't measure things, precisely the things we want to measure, so we make up these statistics, and then we draw some conclusion about them, and then we apply that conclusion back to the thing we wanted to measure, often without maybe thinking as carefully as we need to about whether the thing we measured has all that much to do with the thing we were trying to measure. So according to this statistic, Klay didn't have a hot hand in a 60-point game, which I think everybody would disagree with. It's as much a statement about the thing we measured as it is about Thompson. It's certainly unusual to ever score 60 points in a game, and it's unusual to score 70% of your shots. So, especially when you took that many of them. So there was something very unusual about that game, but it clearly did not appear in this measure of the streakiness of the sequence. So that is most of what I have to say. Just to summarize, that we picked an experiment deliberately to mimic something that was done historically, to see how a historical conclusion would have fared today, even after there was an error in it. Seems to have fared just fine, although we may have learned a little bit about that statistic, especially looking at those funny histograms might make you think a little bit about them too. We did find that there was no evidence of hot hand in the original sense of the measurement by these three very famous guys. And it was true even though correcting the small sample bias lowered the bar for finding exceptional behavior. But this is not all there is to the story. There's arguments going on about the hot hand all the time in newspapers, in academic journals, in sports. Do winners repeat? Certainly on Wall Street, right? Is this manager's luck or skill? Is this success? We hear these things all day long. And the one thing that I am very sure about is that thing I learned in 2011 when I read Kahneman's book is that the way in which we misperceive random effects, look for narratives in them, insist that there's some reason why this thing happened or that thing happened, is very profound and seemingly uncorrectable. So that's Tversky on your left as you face, and Kahneman on the right. By 1985, when Tversky's paper was published, both of them were already famous, but they weren't born famous. The paper that put them on the map is called Belief in the Law of Small Numbers. So if you know the law of large numbers, this is a joke, right? The law of large numbers is that if you take an average over a whole lot of numbers, it's close to the true average if your numbers were drawn independently out of a sample, right? So large data sets can tell you things, but what they were, this was one of the first error types that they documented in the literature in 1971 in this paper, that we tend to draw too much inference from small samples. It's a human tendency. It maybe keeps us get eaten from bears, right? You kind of take guy takes a step towards you, you better run away, right? We make decisions instinctively, not so cerebrally, very quickly, based on very small amounts of data. And Kahneman and Tversky concluded that the true believer in the law of small numbers commits his multitude of sins against the logic of statistical inference in good faith, without intentionally making that mistake. It was exactly a small sample error that Tversky made 14 years later. So there you go. And here are the Splash Brothers. When we did the study, one criticism we got is that we were looking at the wrong players. In fact, Kevin Durant was the star of that series. And so we looked at him, and he didn't have a hot hand either. Maybe with that, I can take questions.
Have any studies been done on cold hands? It just seems intuitive that there would be such a thing as a cold hand.
You mean that it's more likely
somebody's not feeling well, somebody, you know, a player, for whatever reason, he's psychologically, he's thinking about something else, he's going through personal issues. Forgetting about the math behind it, it seems intuitive that there would be such a thing as a cold hand. So if a player normally hits 50% of his shots, and we do see that because of psychological issues, because of playing with the flu, whatever, he's going to have games where there is such a thing as a cold hand, then doesn't that mean that there has to be a hot hand to make up for that to get to the 50%?
Uh-huh. So you're saying that the weighted average of the game averages has to be the season average, I think.
Right.
Okay. So that's a little bit different. Before I try to answer that, I will say that we looked at a number of variants on the statistic that we used. I don't happen to like that statistic. I think we did it because we were asking a particular question. In the original paper and also in our analysis, we looked at other statistics as well, like are there unusual runs in the sequence, which is very related. We didn't find any difference when we used different statistics, but pretty much all the ones that we looked at involved conditional probability or run or what happened after. Now, you're asking, I think, a different question. You're asking if the shooting percentage is unusually low or unusually high, is that the hot hand? Which is, I think, a question we talked about, and I don't remember if we looked at it very carefully, but I'm actually looking at that question with a remarkable young man who is 15 years old, and he's really awesome. So to your point, if Steph Curry's shooting percentage, say, is 50%, no one expects him to shoot 50% in every single game, but maybe we don't expect him to shoot half his games 0 and half his games 100% either. Asking a question about whether there's an unusual concentration of game averages in the tails instead of concentrated around the season average is a question we formulated, and I have a few individual players, but I think my friend Manav is running this for, I think, about 40 players over 4 seasons, so we should have lots of answers soon, but I don't have one yet. And I do like that formulation of a hot hand. I will say that we ran it for Clay Thompson right away, because we always check Clay. He's supposed to be the streakiest player, and he got all kinds of hassle early in the 2018-2019 season for the first few games when he didn't play very well, and people were throwing up their hands, and his career's over. Clay can't hit a three-pointer, and then all of a sudden he seemed to snap out of it. But in the data we looked at so far, actually, there was nothing unusual about Clay's distribution of averages compared to a a random randomly generated benchmark.
We
didn't see anything special in him. We did in Westbrook. We found some extreme behavior, but we're just getting started. Yeah, of all kinds.
I think this is related to what you just said, but for this statistic, if someone is, say, 10 out of 10 in a game, they're not hot, because the permutation statistic will get the same number with all the permutations as with the original statistic, because one probability is zero. And, right.
It's not a discerning statistic.
Right.
Right. But the question, it depends on what question you want to answer. I mean, even though the statistics that measure these conditional probabilities are highly undiscerning, when you're watching that game, you are sure something unusual is going on. So this is the point of Tversky and Kahneman, that our perception, I mean, I think you're right that this is just maybe a low power problem, but the difference between what you can discern with statistics and what you feel with, like, your pulse rate are very different.
Right. And I guess related to that, basketball is a situation where there's a lot of shots, but in something like football, there's only a few passes or a few runs a game. Have you looked at these kinds of hot or cold hands over a season? Like, are six-game winning streaks indicator of a hot team or not?
Well, I've thought about it, and I think even the original study, it was done on longer strings, but I don't really see how, because how do you deal with the ends of the game? I mean, this drives me crazy in financial economics data, right? The people with these continuous time models, but what about nights and weekends? You know, that the market closes, there's these big discontinuities, and it's somehow ignored in a lot of the studies. So this, to my mind, I don't know, Alan, if you think any differently, kind of took account of those discrete chunks in which the data naturally came to us. I would have made it more discrete if I'd had my way and had more data, and not less discrete, in order to try and discuss the phenomenon.
I'm wondering, so you used randomly permuted strings to bootstrap distributions for your T2 statistic. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering how the results change if you use just completely randomly generated strings, such that the probability of success is the same.
We did that. Didn't matter.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is a great talk. It gave me a lot to think about. I don't follow basketball at all, so my entire knowledge of the subject is not from your talk. but a theme of your talk was the tension between the mathematical academics and the practitioners' empirical observations. And I'm wondering, from listening to you, if you're even asking the same question. Because you were looking, you kind of framed your talk as Curry and Thompson, and then you were also looking at the Warriors in general, looking at a specific player and seeing their streakiness.
Mm-hmm.
But in the beginning of your presentation, I think you quoted a news article saying that, oh, now Bill Bradley has the hot hand.
Right.
So that seems to me that they're thinking of the hot hand as something that exists and passes from player to player. So if that's the case, then yes, somebody's always going to be statistically ahead. And you were saying that person gets passed to more often, so their overall scoring is going to be higher, even if their percentage isn't. But then if they don't, well, they cooled off, and now the hot hand is over here. So I'm wondering if the academics and the practitioners are even asking the same question when they're talking about the hot hand.
Well, that's a good point, and I rarely find academics and practitioners talking about, well, I rarely find academics and academics talking about exactly the same thing, but I do. We did look at specific games where there was clearly kind of a high intensity going on, and this statistic, like in the one with Clay with 60 points, I think that the commentators many times during that game probably accused Clay of having a hot hand, and this statistic did not do that. So your point is taken, but I don't think it negates the subject we've presented here.
Hi, you actually touched on my question. When I heard the first time hot hand, I was thinking of when I grew up in New York City, and we played 21, and you were talking about a more discrete streak. So when I saw that string, I was wondering why you would just, how you could put a string like that, because to me, in basketball, you shoot, and if you make it again, right then, right after that shot, as opposed to just a whole 60, do they still play 60 minutes? I mean, they keep changing the rules.
48.
So that the discreteness to me would be, actually almost can't be compared, because with a field shot, you get one or two shots, so then I'd be more impressed if somebody gets it in and gets it in again, as opposed to within a quarter, they make a lot of shots, but you don't know what happens in between. Am I making my question clear?
Completely.
That, to me, it's a slightly different statistic. I'm interested, yes, how many, who can hit, who can make 60 points is really good, but did he make it all in one quarter? Did, how much space did he have time? To me, is a more, has more of an, has more to deal with the hot-handedness than just looking at the totality.
So that is a really wonderful question. And when I gave this talk at the Berkeley Institute for Data Science, I got the same question from a data scientist who wanted to take account of the temporal effects, how quickly the shots came together and so on. And that, I think, would be very, very interesting. And given the incredible wealth of basketball data on the web, I think that's something we could do kind of any time. So great question, but I don't know. And it would have to be formulated, like, we would have to make a new statistic. We would have to think about it.
Let's give our speaker one last hand.